everybody. I am Catherine with the Cumberland River Compact, and today we are at 7 Mile Creek, and we are going to be exploring what lives in healthy streams. That's our big question for today. And I've got some other friends standing a nice distance behind me that are going to introduce themselves as well.
Hi, I'm Alex from the Cumberland River Compact.
And I'm Annie Goodhue with the Cumberland River Compact.
So we are excited to be out with you today exploring our creek critters, so let's get started.
Let's start by making observations of our stream for 30 seconds. Observations are what we can find out by using our senses of sight, hearing, smell, taste, or touch. An example of an observation is, I notice this leaf is a lighter green on the bottom than it is on the top. Now, let's chat with Annie about what might live in our stream.
Okay, here we are creekside, and today I'm wondering what kind of animals, what kind of little critters do we think live in this creek, and where might they be, y'all? The critters that we're going to look at today are benthic macroinvertebrates. And let me break that down for you real quick. Benthic just means bottom. These little critters, these little aquatic insects, they live all in the stream underneath the gravel, cobble, and rocks, so they're benthic on the bottom. Now, macro means large, but these critters are small, but they're large enough to see in your hand, so macro. Invertebrate, no backbone. We have a backbone. These little critters have an exoskeleton. So we are gonna look for benthic macroinvertebrates, these little aquatic insects, these creek critters, in this creek, and see what we can find and see about the stream's health. And the way these benthic macroinvertebrates are going to tell us if this stream is healthy or not are two key things. Diversity, we want to find a lot of variety of these critters, a lot of variety of benthic macroinvertebrates, and we want to find pollution-sensitive organisms, organisms that can't live in pollution.
Take a look at something that I found. Does it look like anything you have ever seen before? Do you recognize any of its features? This is an example of a benthic macroinvertebrate. This might surprise you, but this is actually a dragonfly. Most of the time we see dragonflies flying around, but they spend the first part of their life in the water. They spend up to 4 years living in a creek before they emerge from the water and fly. If benthic macroinvertebrates live at the bottom of our stream, how do you think we can collect them? Let's head back with Annie to see how she collects critters from our creek.
Okay, here we've got a bunch of bank roots that come out into the water underneath, and that's a really good habitat for a lot of different kinds of benthic macroinvertebrates. I've got my net, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start at the bottom, put my net down underneath these bank roots, and then I'm gonna take jabs as I bring my net up to the surface. Try it. See if I get some critters here. Alright, well let's see. We're gonna kick this riffle and cobble and boulders actually too in this bedrock seam. So let's just get a net in here. Get it down flat. We want to get it down as flat as we can there. And then I'm gonna start disturbing this substrate. Dig your toes in down a couple of inches. Have that net right behind downstream of where you're kicking. Also, you can use your hands to disturb the substrate. You get those rocks right in there, kind of rub them off. That works too. You're hiding in there, and we just want to get them to come out. Sometimes they might be embedded a little bit, so you gotta really dig in there. Do the creek dance, the creek shuffle.
These are some of the different benthic macroinvertebrates that we can find in our streams. Do you recognize any of these? These critters help us understand how healthy or unhealthy our water is,
For a stream to be healthy, we want to have organisms from each of these groups, but especially from the pollution-sensitive group, because they can only live in clean water. If we find a lot of them, we know our water is healthy. The somewhat pollution-sensitive group can handle some pollution in their water, but not a lot. And this group, the pollution-tolerant group, can handle a lot of pollution in their water. So a healthy stream will have benthic macroinvertebrates from each of these groups, but mainly the pollution-sensitive group, because everyone can live in clean water.
Let's take a minute to observe some of the benthic macroinvertebrates that we collected today. While I was observing, I saw a damselfly and a crayfish. Did you see anything else while you were observing the tray?
Thanks, Miss Annie, for showing us all those really cool different creek critters. Now, we know that our benthic macroinvertebrates like to live in clean water, but we also know that our water isn't always that clean. How do you guys think that humans can affect or impact how clean or dirty our water is? Let's look at a few different ways that we can impact our water.
Did you notice the trees along the edges of our stream? Healthy streams have something called a riparian zone along the edge where the land meets the water. This is the natural growth of trees, bushes, and grass that provides protection for the stream. It's like the stream's superpower. The riparian zone can help filter pollution before it gets to the water, provide shade and keep the water cool, and provide habitat and food for aquatic critters that live along the banks and in the water. You can help streams near you by making sure that the riparian zone stays protected. Did you notice any dirt in the water while we were exploring? The riparian zone helps to stop dirt or sediment from getting into our streams and rivers. And having too much sediment in the water can be bad because it makes it hard for critters like our benthic macroinvertebrates to breathe. Did you notice any trash or litter on the ground? Well, when it rains, that trash eventually makes its way into our streams. And just like you and I like clean water, so do our creek critters. So we want to try and keep our water pollution-free.
You can help protect the streams and rivers near you by making sure you keep those trees, bushes, and grasses growing right near the water. Remember, that's the superpower of the stream, the riparian zone. And of course, if you see any trash or litter on the ground, you can make sure to pick it up before it enters into our streams and rivers. Now, let's take a look at what we've learned today. Thank you so much for exploring our creek critters with us today. See you next time.